So good evening and welcome to the weekly service from the Elim Church in the Holm Valley. We're delighted that you've joined us on this occasion. I know that tonight we're going to be blessed as we worship together and as we study God's word together. Amen. It is Remembrance Sunday here in the UK, so Nathan is going to lead us in a prayer as we remember those that have given their lives for us in conflicts over the ages. Thank you, Nathan.
On this day, we remember all those who have suffered during wars and conflicts around the world. We remember those who sacrificially gave their lives so that we can know the freedoms we enjoy today and are forever thankful. We remember those scarred by warfare. We remember those who have returned from conflicts physically disabled and suffering pain. We pray that they would know you and your strength in their struggles. We remember those tormented by war and suffering post-traumatic stress. We pray that they would know your peace and healing to their troubled minds. We remember families who have suffered loss, parents who have lost children, children who have lost parents, wives who have lost husbands, husbands who have lost wives. On this day, when the memories of loss are at the forefront, we pray that those who mourn would know your comfort. We pray for all members of the armed forces who are in danger this day, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return. We pray for peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep this world secure and free. We pray for those in authority that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. We ask for gifts of wisdom and resolve in search for reconciliation and peace. As we remember the sacrifice of others, we remember the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus, who laid down his life for us that we may be free. Amen.
And Father, we pray for others known to us, others close to us. Father, we speak healing over their lives in Jesus' name. And Father, right now, we just receive from you as well, because you are the Lord, our healer. And Father, we just look to you for strength and for grace to flow in our lives for your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Gal.
So tonight's scripture is Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 to 18. Even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, that sounds pretty bleak, doesn't it? Does life ever feel like that, hard and barren and empty? But the psalmist continues, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. What do you do when everything seems to be going wrong, when there seems to be no light at the end of the tunnel, and when the enemy seems to be coming in strong against you? Well, the first song we're going to sing gives us some guidance. It says, raise a hallelujah in the presence of your enemy. Raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Raise a hallelujah. Our weapon is a melody. Raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing in the middle of the storm. Sing in the middle of the storm. It's easy to sing when everything's going well. We can easily proclaim the word of God over our lives when everything is good and the sunshine's shining and nothing's coming against us. But in the middle of the storm, the word of God is still true. God is still on his throne. The Holy Spirit still lives inside you, and God is moving in your life in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, let your praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. Hallelujah. Psalm 18:3 says, I will call upon the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. Hallelujah. In the middle of the storm, when the enemy is coming against you, you keep your eyes on God and you sing and you praise him and you worship him. Hallelujah. Let's do that right now.
Thank you.
We thank you that in the middle of the storm, we have a name that is higher than any other name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that in the middle of the storm, we have a rock beneath our feet that is firmer and stronger than even the ground we stand on. Hallelujah. The very word of God. Hallelujah. Father, thank you that in the middle of the storm, the light of Christ still shines brightly from our heart. Hallelujah. And thank you, Lord, that in the middle of the storm, we are not defeated. We are more than conquerors. And we have your word, your blood, your name. We have your spirit. And we can still focus on you and speak out our praise. Hallelujah. And heaven comes to fight for us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
One day. you know, I was just in praise and worship, and I was thinking, you know, it's this weekend's a special weekend when we look back and we remember those people who fought for us and served for our country in the past. But do you know, when it comes to you, God never looks back. He doesn't remember all that's gone on before. And I'm sure there's people possibly out there who when they hear pastor saying that, if you knew all the things I've done, you wouldn't say that God wants to forgive me. You wouldn't say that God loves me. But I want to tell you tonight that God doesn't care what you've done in your past. He only cares about your presence and your future. And I meet so many people who are so hung up on things that have happened to them in the past. Yeah. Events that have caused them pain. People who've said things or done things that hurt them, and they can't move on from that place. But God can't change what's happened to you. God can never, ever change your past. Your past is your past. What's happened to you has happened to you. But what God wants to say to you, I believe, is, I want to give you a future. Yeah. I want to give you today. And what God says is, when you come to me, I will forget everything you've ever done. Don't get me wrong, he doesn't forget everything that's ever happened to you. But he says, I will forget everything you've ever done. I will cast it into the sea of my forgetfulness. What God's saying is, start today and move forward. No matter what's happened to you, no matter what you've done, today is the day when God wants you to forgive, forget, and move forward. Hallelujah. With his help. With God on your side, your tomorrows can be wonderful and will be wonderful. But you've got to trust in him, and you've got to start today.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord, that the past is the past. And you are the great I am. You are the God of the present and the God of the future. And Father, I bless you that you've got good things in store for us, because you are a good God, not out to get us, but out to bless us. Father, may we be people who receive your goodness towards us. Amen. Amen. Thank you for that, Chris. Bless you. Hallelujah. I don't know. I'm almost reluctant to share this, but I will share it. I had a dream last night, and, you know, it says in the scripture that old men shall dream dreams. Well, I must be getting old. But I was preaching in my dreaming. And often I have nightmares about turning up to preach and not having a message to preach, you know, sort of thinking that I've got a message to preach, but I've got nothing prepared. I have nightmares about this. But there was just two phrases in the sermon that I was preaching that I didn't know whether it means anything to anybody. I'll encourage you with it anyway. And I was just trying to think whether it linked in with what Chris said or not, but I'll share it anyway. It's the phrase that God is not simply the God of the there and then, but he is the God of the here and now. Amen. And I wanted to encourage you that God is with you now. He's not a God that is just in the past and talked about by our grandmothers and our grandparents and those of old, but he is a living God today who wants to make a difference in our lives today. And maybe you're watching at home, maybe you're here in the congregation this evening, and you came in looking for a miracle, and you were thinking, well, I read about the miracles in the past, but I need a miracle today. Be encouraged, because God is the miracle worker who wants to do good things in your life today. Amen. Praise God. So be encouraged by that. So, scriptures on the screen from where we were last week. We're doing a study of Mark, and we're going all the way through. So here it is, Mark 1:22. Somebody clever amongst us might calculate how long it will be before I finish this series. But we've got to verse 22 so far. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Normally, when you went to the synagogue on the Sabbath, you would normally expect to hear a dry and dusty sermon from a scribe or from a rabbi who would quote other rabbis. And normally, the sermon would be centered around about what you could and couldn't do on the Sabbath. And everybody went out of that synagogue on that Sabbath day morning wondering whether they were going to be zapped by God because they'd walked too many steps, whether they'd turned a light switch on by mistake, done the washing up by mistake, or whatever. It was a message that probably left them in fear as they went out the door and not very encouraged and not very uplifted. So Jesus comes on the scene and he preaches a different message, not one that is quoting the rabbis, but probably one that is quoting the word of God. He speaks a message and they are astonished. They were stunned. If you remember what I said last week is that the Greek word is almost as if they were knocked for six. Bowled over is another expression that we might use in the English language. They were stunned. They were astonished. They were amazed. And they went out of that building that morning, not in fear, but saying to one another, "Wow, did you just hear what I heard? Did you just see what..." And they were probably pinching themselves, wondering whether they had just experienced what they had heard. They were astonished at the authority of his teaching. And last week we speculated about what Jesus was preaching about. If the rabbis and the scribes talked about the Sabbath, it might well be that he spoke about the Sabbath. But I believe that he spoke through a lens of grace rather than the lens of the law. Now you might say to me, "Ian, how do you speculate? Why can you say with confidence that you think that Jesus was talking through the lens of grace rather through the lens of law?" Well, if we look at a scripture from Luke 4, when Jesus was speaking again on another occasion, it says here, "So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words that proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, 'Isn't this Joseph's son?'" They marveled at what? His gracious words. His gracious words. And you might say to myself, Ian, you might say to me, Ian, the word marveled is not the same word as astonished. Well, funny enough, I looked up in my Greek dictionary what the word marveled means. And the definition there is listed as astonished, amazed. So it's a bit of a synonym to the word astonished. So I think that it's not stretching the scripture too far or stretching the message, my message, too far to suggest that when Jesus spoke, he spoke a message of grace about the Sabbath. And last week I said to you that instead of preaching about what you should and shouldn't do on the Sabbath, he reminded the people that the Sabbath was created for man and man not for the Sabbath. And that the Sabbath is a picture of grace. And I look back at that example of in the wilderness when the children of Israel were hungry and the Lord provided manna. He provided twice as much on the Sabbath, twice as much on the day before the Sabbath. So they didn't have to collect. They didn't have to work on the Sabbath. And I said to you that this is a picture of grace. How so? Because it's a picture of how God provided beforehand without works. We didn't have to work. God provided. And it's a picture of salvation by grace because, again, we don't have to work to be saved. It is already provided. We can rest because of what has already been provided, Jesus' death on the cross for us. Somebody said to me, "Ian, I thought the Sabbath was all about what we shouldn't and shouldn't do on the Sunday." No, it is a picture about what Jesus has done for us so that we don't have to work. Wow, you mean to say that everything in the Old Testament that talks about the Sabbath is a picture of grace? Yes, it is. It's a picture that we don't have to work because God has provided for us. Hallelujah. Praise God. Right. Authority. So let's have a look at what this scripture again says here. It says, and they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught with them as one having authority. Now, I started to think to myself, why is it that these people thought that Jesus had authority when he taught? And I thought to myself a few things. I thought, is it that he said, you must do this and you must do that? And he barked commands so that they all sort of were sort of shuffled up in obedience very quickly. A bit like a sergeant major shouting a command in authority. Was it that he shouted things and commanded their obedience? I don't believe so. Here are at least five things or four or five things that I've identified perhaps that we could say why they thought that Jesus taught with authority. Here's number one. Jesus taught with authority because he spoke from authority. So you remember how the rabbis and the scribes quoted other rabbis, and they would have their long, dry and dusty sermons, and they would be saying, Rabbi so-and-so says this, and Rabbi so-and-so says this, and Rabbi so-and-so, well, he says this. Well, when Jesus stood up, he didn't say, Rabbi so-and-so says this. He says, this is what the word of God says. He taught from authority. He taught from the word of God, which is the ultimate authority. And there is an application for us because when people criticize us, I remember being criticized myself by, you wouldn't believe it, another church minister who said to me that I couldn't say that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except by me. You know, and he says, well, he says, I think you're a bit of a bigot if you say that. But I wasn't quoting a university professor. I wasn't quoting a politician. I wasn't even quoting my own opinion. I was quoting the words of Jesus. He is the superior authority. I couldn't say it was my idea, not the tradition of men. It's what Jesus, it's what Jesus said. Our authority is not the Daily Mirror. It's not the Daily Telegraph. It's not what a politician or a pop star says. It's not even what a Church of England bishop says. Or the Pope says. Or even the General Superintendent of Elim says. Hallelujah. Did someone say hallelujah there? It's what God says in his word. Then I think that Jesus taught with authority because he knew what he was talking about. If you were to give me a recipe for a lemon sponge and say, stand in front of a group of people and follow this recipe and teach them how to make a lemon sponge, well, I would get the ingredients together. I would read the recipe. It would say, beat the eggs. Do you put eggs in a sponge? Beat the eggs and the flour and the butter, and must have some lemon in the lemon sponge somewhere. So beat those all together. And I'd say, you do it like this. And I was fumbling all over the place and making a right mess of it. And then thinking to myself, well, how do we put it in the tin? And what's it mean? You know, I have enough trouble turning the oven on, let alone. So if you watched me trying to teach you how to bake a lemon sponge, fumbling through, muddling through, you would say to me, you didn't teach that with much authority. You didn't teach that with much credibility. The reason why Jesus taught with authority, because he knew what he was talking about. Of course, Jesus is God. He's part of the Godhead, part of the Holy Trinity. He is the author of the scripture. If he wrote it, he knows what it means. So he knew what he was talking about. But then also, You could also surmise that Jesus taught with authority because he knew what he taught. Oh, I've just said that, haven't I? He knew what he taught. Believed what he taught. Thank you. Thought these notes were, these points were quite similar, but not that similar. Thank you, Alison. He taught with authority because he believed what he taught. Now, I'm not likening Jesus to a car salesman here, so don't tell me off afterwards. But if there were a car salesman, and he was the car salesman at the Volkswagen dealer, and he said to me, he says, what you need to do, you need to be to buy a Volkswagen Golf. They are the best cars on the planet. You need to get one. Everybody should have one. They won't let you down. They're very good value. They're affordable, what have you. You ought to have one. Everybody ought to have one. And then you said to him, what car have you got? And he says, well, I've got a Vauxhall Astra. Well, you'd think to yourself, you've just told me everybody needs to have a Volkswagen and you've got an Astra. He obviously didn't believe what he taught. But if the Volkswagen dealer said, you need to have a Volkswagen because they're the best cars in the world, and he said, I've had one since I was first started to drive, and I've had five in my lifetime, and everyone's been reliable, they've not cost me a penny, and you know, I've never broken down once. He believes what he's selling. Now, likewise, and remember, I'm not comparing Jesus to a salesman, but the illustration that I'm making is that Jesus taught with authority, because not only did he quote the word of God, not only did he know what he was talking about, but he believed what he was talking about. And then I think there's another point that we could make, and that why another reason why Jesus had authority, because everything that he said made sense. Suddenly, the people when the people heard Jesus speak, they identified with what he was saying, and they said, "Yeah, I can believe that. That's good. Yeah, it's a bit like me. If you came to me and you said, you've got cold hands," and I said to you, "Well, the thing you need to do is you need to put another pair of socks on." What? And you'd say, "Well." But if I said to you, well, you've got cold hands, what you need to do is put a pair of gloves on, that makes sense. And when all the rabbis were talking about the law and about what you could and couldn't do, it was like somebody saying, here's the problem that we've got. We've got cold hands. Put another pair of socks on. It just didn't make sense. It just didn't connect. But when Jesus started to reveal the truth about the Sabbath, the grace, and people started to think, yeah, we always thought that God was a God of love. We always thought that God was on our side. We always thought that God was a God of blessing. Deep down, we knew. But yet all this time, people have told us that God has been out to get us. What this chap is telling us makes sense. So maybe that's another reason why they thought Jesus taught with authority. But then let's link the next reason to the next couple of verses. Now, there was a man in the synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him saying, "Be quiet, come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had convulsed in him and cried out with a loud voice, he came out of him. Then they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And immediately his fame spread throughout all the region and around Galilee. So three times we read this word unclean spirit, this is just a little bit of background before I get on to my final point about Jesus' authority. What are unclean spirits? They are demon spirits or demonic spirits, demons. Some liberal theologians might say, well, actually, there are no such things as demons today. They are all superstitions. And, when we read about this, it's old wives' tale. And we just got to take everything that we read about demons with a pinch of salt. Don't take it seriously. But then if we were to say that, we would make the gospel writers, we would make the Jesus himself a liar. We don't get our theology from what tradition says, but from what the Bible says. Demons are fallen angels that followed Satan when he rebelled against God. Revelation 12:9 gives us clarity. So the great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth and his angels were cast out with him. And Revelation 12:14, a four says he swept down a third of the stars of heaven. Now, I'm not going to concentrate on demons and give attention to Satan too much right now, but I will say a few things and answer a few common questions, and you'll see where I'm going in a moment or two. So, are there demons today, or are they some vague superstition? Well, I've already told you that we believe in the Bible, and then again, I've told you that the other week when we talked about angels, and we believe in angels. And if demons are fallen angels, a third of the angels rebelled with Satan. Satan took a third of the angels with him. Well, then demons are just as real as angels. That's why, I'm not one to endorse Halloween parties. You know, when people sort of start glorifying death and darkness and goodness knows what. Don't get me wrong, I'm not spoiling people's fun or wanting to be a party spoiler or anything like that. But at the very least, when we start going around and spooking people and highlighting death and fear, we are joining the powers of darkness. So we need to be very careful that we don't start playing along with the enemy, playing along with demons, because they are very real. Can a Christian be demon possessed? This is a very common question that is often asked me. Simple answer is no. Why? Because who is it that dwells in you? Who is it who dwells in the believer? It is the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit who possesses us. It is the Holy Spirit who leads us, who guides us, who gives us life, who leads us and conforms us into the image of Christ. We are not possessed by a demon who leads us and guides us and conforms us to all kinds of evil. The Holy Spirit possesses us. There is no room for the enemy in our spirits. Okay. Back to our scripture, and I'll answer another common question about demons and link it to the authority of Jesus. Now, there was a man in the synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "Let us alone. What are we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Now, one of the things that some people ask me is, how is it that the man became demon-possessed? And like I said before, we need to be very careful about what we play with, Ouija boards and into witchcraft and into all kinds of cult things and into all kinds of sexual deviation. You open yourself up to the enemy's work in your lives. Being involved in drugs is an open invitation for the devil to come and mess with your life. We can talk about more of this at home groups. But look where the man with the unclean spirit was sitting, in the synagogue. The man with the unclean spirit had gone to the synagogue year after year after year and had remained silent. How is it that when Jesus turns up, there is a reaction? I believe it's because the rabbis didn't speak the word of God. But then Jesus comes along and he speaks the truth and he evokes a reaction. The word of God from the lips of Jesus acted like a sword that pierced the demon. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirits and joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of hearts. Listen to what John 8:44 says. Jesus is talking to of the devil, but demons will have the same characteristics. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth because there is no truth in him. So there's two reactions that we can have to the word of God. Number one, we can be astonished. We can be amazed. We can our jaws can drop and we could say, that is amazing. Wow. I didn't know that God loved me so much. I didn't know that God was for me and not against me. Wow. We can have that reaction. Or another reaction that we see here is one of a shriek, or one of a panic, or one of fear. Leave me alone. They metaphorically put their hands over their ears. I do not want to hear the truth. Because the truth touches a raw nerve. And we can go into some churches today and we can say that Jesus is Lord, and they will say, shut up! We don't want to hear that truth. We can quote the scripture where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And there will be people who are sitting in the pews hear that and they say, shut up, we don't want to hear the truth. I was talking to somebody earlier on in the week and they said that a few years back they'd gone to this church in Wales and it was a very small congregation and they stack out like sore thumbs and they got talking to some of the leadership and they said, nice to see you at this church and what have you. Where have you come from? And the conversation got onto that we're believers. We're born again. We love Jesus. And there was a, Jesus, don't mention his name in here. Almost that reaction. They weren't made to feel welcome. An interesting aside, the powers of darkness are influencing many social attitudes at the moment. Even if we say a woman is a woman and a man is a man, according to their plumbing, there's people who shout out, shut up! We don't want to hear the truth. And Jesus cried out, and the man with the unclean spirit cried out, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. And very quickly, because I can see my time is running out, it's interesting that many people didn't recognize who Jesus was, but the demons do. They knew exactly who he was, the Holy One of God. The devil and the demons know exactly who Jesus is, but they choose not to trust him. They have a knowledge, but they don't apply it. Now, here's another thought, which is quite ironic when you think about it. Satan and his demons believe in God, believe in Jesus, know who he is, and believe in the scripture. They believe more than some people who would call themselves Christians. It was only the other week that when I was quoting talking about the temptations of Jesus, and the devil believes in the word of God. James 2:19 says this, even the demons believe and tremble. The demons believe that Jesus died that you might have life in all its fullness, but they don't want you to believe it. The demons believe in forgiveness, but they don't want you to believe and apply it. The demons believe in healing, but they don't want you to receive it. The demons believe that God loves your unsaved friends and family, but they don't want them to know it. Did you come to destroy us? The demons possessing the man knew their time was limited and their ultimate destiny was the lake of fire. They thought their time was up. I know who you are, the Holy One of God. They knew Jesus had authority, not simply because he quoted the word of God, not simply because he understood what he taught, not simply because he believed what he taught, not simply because of what he said made sense, but he taught with authority because of who he was, the Holy One of God. God has also exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Give me 5 minutes. Are the demons still trying to influence our lives today? Well, we know that they can't possess us because we're born again believers and the Holy Spirit dwells in our spirits. But they do try to mess with our lives. Ephesians 6:12 says this, "For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." This is why we talked about the armor of God a couple of months ago. Do the demons have the right or authority to mess with the Christian's life? No, they do not. Though the evil demons will attempt to attack the believer, they are no match for the Holy Spirit. He who is in you is greater than he than is in the world. The devil has no right to mess with your life. That's why you should not give him an inch. Resist the devil and he will flee. I will pick this up again next week and elaborate a little bit more, but I just need to finish this up with this point. And Jesus came and spoke to them and he said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations." What I'm showing you here is that the authority that Jesus has, he has delegated to us as believers. And so we act upon his authority. So when a policeman, you remember in the old days when the traffic lights used to go out, they used to send a traffic warden or a policeman to stand at the intersection and say, "Stop," and wave the traffic on and stop. Well, there were great heavyweight lorries that would be coming through, great big cars trying to speed through, but the policeman would put his hand up and say, "Stop." And the lorry, however many tons, the 40-ton lorry would stop, not because he had the power of himself to stop it, but because he had the authority of the local police force, the badge. He had authority. And likewise, we have authority over the enemy. We have the authority to say, "Get lost. Don't mess with my life. You have no right to mess with my life." Not because we are strong of ourselves, not because we have any personal authority, but because we have the authority that has been given us, the badge, if you like, of the Holy Spirit, Jesus himself in our lives. Thank you for listening. I've got a lot to say. We'll continue this at home groups. We'll continue it next week. But thank you, Lord, that his name is higher than any other. His name is above all. That at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. And that the enemy has no authority because Jesus has ultimate authority. The enemy has no authority over our lives because he who is in us, Jesus, is greater than he. Amen. Thank you, Argyle. Thank you. Hallelujah. The great I am, the God of the here and now. If you want us to pray with you for your miracle, And we'll gladly do that. Don't go without being prayed for, if that's you. If you want to call me at home or ask for a prayer request online, you can do so. You can call me at home, 01484323978, on my mobile, 0747 277 3243. You can email me at info@hvelim.org.uk. Thank you for coming. Don't forget that this week it's home groups on the 15th and the 17th of November, 7 o'clock at Cafe Plus. It'd be good to see you there, and we can talk about what I've talked about this evening and be encouraged. You can ask questions too. Or don't forget that God is good, that He loves you, He's for you and not against you, and that you are blessed. Blessed by the blessed. Amen. We'll see you again soon. Thanks for coming. Amen.